Huwag muna kayo mag-walking kasi crowded yan. Please, pag nag-walking ka. Dito na lang tayo magkasama-sama katawan dito sa church. Sama tayo-tayo, palakas tayong katawan, exercise, para po hindi tayo tamaan ng virus. Yan po. Amen po?
Amen.
Amen. Yeah, agree po. Particular na pampalakas. Kahit ano po, pwede rin yung ano, basketball, pero kayong bahala. Yan lang naman po ay concern lang po sa inyong mga kalusugan. Ayun po, so I didn't want to preach even last week and today because tag dito, hindi naman, it's not that my heart is full of hatred, but maybe parabang disappointment because of a lot of things that I've been tag dito reading on Facebook, social media. Nakaka-apekto rin po minsan kasi hindi naman not because of anything but just because of some people that you expect to know the word of God, na minsan nakaka-disappoint na kanila mga statements sa social media. So I thought na parabang hirap matapos yung preaching, but then I thought na why not use these statements to preach this morning. So that's what I'm going to do. Anyway, dito po sa Nehemiah chapter 10 to 13 would be yesterday. Last week we studied their commitment to the Lord and their the renewal of commitment, and the chapters 10 to 13 is stating the way they paano nilang na organize uli yung bansa and how they were able to keep that commitment to the Lord. But this morning we'll be we'll be studying something different here in 2 Timothy. So may I ask everyone to stand, please. 2 Timothy 3:13 to 17. Please bear with me. I don't know if we'll how long this will be, but let's just see. 2 Timothy 3:13 to 17. Let's read it responsibly. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus.
All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness.
Altogether, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning and the time for Sunday school and studying word. I pray that you help us as we go through some statements that are not biblical, and I pray that through the Bible we're going to be able to be clear about them, and that we will not be deceived, dear Lord, by today's Christianity. And we realize, Lord, that even though many people call themselves Christians, they're not really lovers of the word of God. And I pray, Lord, that you help us through this message. I pray that everyone will be that are here will be attentive and will be humble enough, dear Lord, to receive instruction from your word. Help me as I preach. May be the one to give me the ability and the grace, dear Lord, during this time. For all these things, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Bro, palakas konti, bro. Okay, so as I have said, we're studying something different today because since I have been reading a lot of these things and been exchanging with many people, tried to compile what they were saying, just the general things, the things that most of them say, and the things that many consider to be true, and that principles that they try to live by, but not realizing that it is against the word of God, or not found in the word of God, or in direct contradiction to the word of God. But we know that today Christianity is like a positive only Christianity. It's like love everyone, don't fight with anyone, accept anyone's belief, make sure that you are at peace with all men, and all of these things. This is the result of shallow and soft Christianity. This is the result of people who want to follow the Lord but don't want anything to do with the Word of God. And these are people who want to be called Christians but do not want to know the meaning of that word. And many people today say, when you go to social media, you see a lot of statements that are very ridiculous. And today I would like to offer some statements that to us we know generally are not true, but then at the end of the message we'll go back to the text and offer some statements that maybe some of us here today believe, but we don't realize that it's actually against the Word of God. And there are statements that are really just ridiculous, like, let's just love one another, follow your heart, all religions lead to God anyway. When you die, you're going to be an angel. Actually, all of those, you're going to read that in the Bible, in social media. But then, these are people who call themselves Christians. But again, they're unlearned. They do not read the Bible. That's why they are able to say all these things. So, first few points here. I just want to give some statements that are mas madaling ma-refute. So that, because I know if some of you desire to be talking to these people and try to refute their philosophy in life or their principles, you need to know how to use the Word of God. Because if you just reason out with them without using the Word of God, then really you have no authority. And they have no obligation to listen to you. But then if you can prove it through the Word of God, then all the better. So how can we prove these things wrong using the Word of God? Because last week I was made, dito, mayroon nag-chat sa akin, ginawa nila akong, they made me a moderator of a debate group. And the title of the group is Baptist versus, and then all of the names of the cults, like INC, lalat, kung ano-ano. And then, sige, pasok ako sa group, sabi ko. So I scanned through the posts, and really, some of the posts are really funny because all of these cults are posting their beliefs, and you see how they twist the Word of God and how they use the Word of God in order to para bang ma-justify yung belief nila. And to my surprise, there are Baptists who do not believe the deity of Christ. While I was reading, it's like I was scratching my head. It's like, how can these people call themselves Baptists if they do not believe the deity of Christ? They say that Christ is only made by God, therefore He is not God. And they still call themselves Baptists. So parabang, I thought I saw the worst in all of those, in all of the arguments that I read on Facebook, but that is so far one of the worst things that a Baptist can say, because these are fundamental beliefs that we have to believe, and if you don't, then you are unsaved. And you're definitely not, should not be called a Baptist. So, first statement that I want to give here is, God wants me to be happy. Last night, I cannot sleep. And, I had some revelations. I shared it to the group, to our chat group. But then, one more thing, I came across this remix of Joel Austin's Ultimate Narcissistic Remix. Lahat ng mga IM niya, tas may background music. Gala, pakinggan nyo po. Mapapasayaw kayo sa remix na yon. But then, he says a lot of I am. And one of his messages, God wants me to be happy. God wants me to be rich. God wants me to have all of these things in my life. But it may be true that ultimately, God wants to have us to have joy in our lives. But in today's world, when they say that God wants me to be happy, it is as if they're treating God as someone who will just fulfill their wishes in order to make them happy. Now, God is not that kind of God. And we know that it is not the ultimate will of God for us to be happy, but it's the will of God only for us to obey Him, for us to follow His will. The Bible says in Luke chapter 9, verse 23, and He saith to them all, if any man will come after me or wants to be my disciple, if anyone wants to be a believer, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. Now, Christ actually told us that if we really want to follow Him, we need to deny ourselves. And denying ourselves may mean forget the things that make you happy, forget the things that make you have pleasure in life, even forget about your goals, forget about your dreams. Erase everything that you plan for and let the Lord write His will for your life. That is what the Lord expects from us, not for us just to be happy. Because today, when we look, hear Christianity and some preachers preaching, it is as if being a Christian is the answer to everything in life. Well, it is. The Bible is the answer to everything in life. But to them, it is the answer to be happy in life, to be happy all the time. Like if you're a believer, you will be living a life that is more joyful than anyone else. Yes, it's true, but it's not in the context of getting what you want in this world. It's not in the context of getting what your flesh desires, but it is in the context we get our joy and happiness by knowing that we are fulfilling the will of God in our lives. And that, in that way, that kind of happiness, that kind of joy, obeying God may not give us happiness at the moment. Because when you look at the lives of the apostles in the Bible, actually most of them, when they started to take up their cross and follow Christ, it seemed like they had no more peace in their lives. They had no more happiness, the happiness that this world thinks of. Because the moment they started following God, people started seeking for their lives. People started persecuting them. People started doing all these bad things about them. And if we just look at it at face value, there's no reason for them to be happy. And being a Christian doesn't automatically give you an easy life. It actually makes your life here on earth more difficult. If being a Christian made your life easier here on earth, then there's something wrong with your Christianity. Why? That means you're still going with the flow of this world. That means that you're still agreeing with the system of this world. That means you're not really going against error, and you're not really going against all these false beliefs that are going around in the world, and you just want everyone to accept you. But that is not what Christ wants us to have. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 4, "Great is my boldness of speech toward you. Great is my glorifying of you. I am filled with comfort. I am exceeding joyful in all our what? Tribulation." Now, Apostle Paul, after he followed Christ, he faced tribulation after tribulation, shipwreck, people stoning him, people throwing him out of the cities. But then that is where he found real joy. That is where he found real happiness. Joy that will never be taken away from you. Joy that is not dictated by the circumstances. Joy that is not dictated by what you have and what you don't have. And this world believed that God is someone who will just grant all your wishes. That if I'm a Christian, he'll make me rich. I'm a Christian, he'll make me happy. He will give me my dream house. He will give me my dream car. This may not be the will of God in your life, but if you're a true Christian, you will find that the will of God in your life is for you to be content and for you to be happy with the things that God is giving you, even though at face value it's not really that something that will give you temporary happiness. Here in Philippians chapter 4 verse 11 and 12, this is the key to Apostle Paul. Why was he joyful even despite all the tribulation? "Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content." Now, the reason why Paul was able to be happy is because he learned how to be content. He says in verse 12, "I know both how to be abased and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I am instructed, both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need." That's why even though the situation may not be happy, he doesn't have a place to dwell. He doesn't always have something to eat. But he said, "I am joyful and I am happy." Why? Because he found real joy in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why if this world says that God just wants me to be happy, God just wants everyone to be happy, that is not actually biblical. Because obeying the will of God may not bring us happiness at the moment we obey the will of God. At the moment when God told you to let go of someone in your life that is pulling you away from Christ, that will not bring you happiness. At the moment of letting go. Right? When God tells you to let go of your dreams, to let go of your ambitions, that may not bring you happiness at that moment. But then ultimately, at the end of the road, we will find real joy in obeying the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I read this statement many times in social media, that God wants me to be happy, that God wants us just all to be joyful, but that is not biblical. Another thing here, God never gives us more than we can handle. And I'm very much guilty of this as well. Because technically, it is not correct. God gives us more than we can handle because we can never handle anything by ourselves. Never. God, we will never be able to handle any problem, however little it is. Why? Because we are merely human. Here in 1 Corinthians 10:13, it seems that it's teaching this. "There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man." Everyone is tempted, everyone is tried. "But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able. But with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may also be able to bear it." Now, whenever we preach this, and it is correct, that God, when he gives you temptation, you will be able to overcome it. But we always forget to take into account the grace of God. We always forget to take to account the ways of God. We always forget to take to account the strength that God gives us. Because we are only able to surpass these trials, these temptations, because of the help of God. And sometimes, and in fact, really, that the reason why God gave us these trials and these temptations is for us to see our own limitation. It's for us to see that we cannot do it without God's help. That we cannot do it without relying upon God. That we have to rely upon Him in everything. The reason why God gives you problems, so that you will realize that we cannot deal with the problems unless we give it to God. The Bible says, Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. It is the grace of God that helps us handle the situation. It's not our own ability. So when we say God gives us more than we can handle, technically what we should say is God will never give us more than His grace can help us with. Right? This is what the Apostle Paul realized here in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8. He says here, "For we would not, brethren, have you ignorant of our trouble, which came to us in Asia, that we were pressed out of measure, above strength, more than we can handle." What's this? What Apostle Paul said? Actually, we are in so much that we despaired even of life. That they thought that they're going to die. That his ministry is going to be cut short. He said that they're pressed out of measure, above what they can handle. But through all this persecution, they were spared only by the grace and mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ, and not by their own ability, not by their own strength. He realized this in 2 Corinthians 12, verse 7 to 9. Because God gives us all these problems and temptations to always keep us humble and to always know our limitations. The Bible says here in verse 7, "Unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations that was given to me, a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure." That is the reason why God gave Paul this trouble and this thing that he cannot by himself remove. Right? He cannot by himself take away from his life. But by the grace of God, he can endure them. What is the reason? The verse says, "Lest I should be exalted above measure." Now, God constantly gives us these temptations, these trials, to always keep us in check. No, you cannot. You have to rely upon me. You have to always rely upon my grace. Verse number 8. "For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me," what? "My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness," or in your weakness. "Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me." So God never gives us more than what his grace can help us with. We cannot handle anything in life, especially in the Christian life, because the devil will throw everything at us. That sometimes, kaya nga po, there's a reason why whenever there's a problem and trial, it always seems impossible at first. When the problem and a trial comes and it arrives, it will always seem impossible. God makes that so that whenever we're able to pass that trial and temptation, we will say it is only by the grace of God. Why? That's the reason why it is given to us. Another statement here before we go back to our text later. Bad things happen to good people. Now, oftentimes you hear asking people, especially now we have this coronavirus outbreak, we say, why do bad things happen to good people? Well, the obvious answer simply is there are no good people, according to the word of God and according to the standard of God. Why? Because all of us are sinners, and in the eyes of God, all of us have failed. All of us have failed to be good. The Bible says in Romans 3:10-3 that Romans chapter 3, I forgot, or 10, there is none righteous, no, not one. And going down to those verses that there is none that doeth good. Why? Because inherently we're all bad. Inherently we're all sinners. And some may look better than others, of course. Some may seem to be better people than others, but technically none of us are good. None of us are good people. We all deserve hell. We all deserve the things that are coming to us. We all deserve all this sorrow and the things that are happening around this world. But again, through the mercy and the grace of God, God is giving us things that we do not even deserve. So bad things happen to good people. It happened only once, and it happened at the cross on the Lord Jesus Christ. Because He is the only good. He's the only one that is good. Because all of us are bad. And the moment you think that you're good, the moment you think that you're good enough, that's the moment that you're going to fail. That's why kaya nga po kailangan, we always have to view everything, our abilities, the things that we do, in the light of God's mercy and grace. Why? Because the moment that we don't do that, pride will set into our hearts, and then that's when we will fall. That's why we have to do. Now, going to the meat of the message, there are things. Now, these three things, example lang po ito, ridiculous things that even most of us here can immediately point out that's wrong. This is what the Bible says. But then there are statements when you go into the groups like the Baptist group and pastors group that seem spiritual and biblical but are really against the Word of God. And these statements are dangerous. Why? Because many believers live their lives applying these principles. Many believers live their lives applying these things, but they are not actually according to the will of God. I want to give you three things. First here, let's just go soul winning.
Mag-aakay na lang tayo ng kaluluwa. Tigilan nyo na yan. Ang mahalaga, nag-aakay tayo ng kaluluwa.
Which is true. Lahat po tayo dapat nag-aakay ng kaluluwa. Lahat po tayo dapat we're preaching the gospel because this is what Christ gave the church. Christ commissioned the church to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, baptizing them in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. That's why that's what we have to do. But we should not forget that doing the good commission doesn't the great commission doesn't mean that we forget everything else. Doesn't mean that we let go of everything else. Why? Because that is not all God wants us to do. That is not all that God wants us to do. And it baffles me. It really cannot understand it. How can they say that people who are contending for the faith are not doing their job evangelizing the world? It's something that I cannot fathom. Why? Because they're telling it to people who are missionaries in the foreign field. Hindi ka kasi nagsasoul winning, ginagano. Hindi ka kasi naggagawa ng great commission. We are in Cambodia. We are in a foreign field. We are missionaries. We're sharing the gospel to places that you're not even willing to go. And you have the audacity to say that to us. Just because we are obeying the Bible and contending for the faith doesn't mean that we're not doing the Great Commission. Why? Kasi kung susundin lang natin yung logic nila, mas maraming verses sa Bible telling us to warn people about false prophets than evangelizing. Paramihan na lang tayo ng verse, talo na sila. But of course, that is not the way we should interpret the Bible. We should take it holistically. You are to evangelize, you are to contend for the faith, you are to give, you are to praise the Lord, you are to worship the Lord. All of these things you have to give focus. Not only evangelizing. Kasi minsan pagka napuno na sila sa discussion, ay, hindi kasi kayo nagsasoul winning, mag-offline na lang kayo, mag-soul winning na lang kayo. Sinasabing hindi kami nagsasoul winning. Right? Now, let's look at some verses. Christ even himself warned us of false prophets. Matthew 7:15 to 24. Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Put into context, this is Jesus Christ himself talking. You shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs or thistles? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Now, all of these verses, I'll read until verse number 24, are God is so good. Christ is so good that He gave us guideline. Paano natin malalaman itong mga tao na peke? Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Therefore, whosoever heareth the sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon the rock. The ministry of warning against false prophets is so important that Christ even took a lot of his Sermon on the Mount to warn out of these things. To warn us of how to know these things. Another statement by Christ, Matthew 24:4-5. And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. This is another one of our duties, not just to win souls. We are to win souls, but Christ commanded this. And if you will live your life thinking that you are only to win souls, then you're neglecting these things that Christ warned us, commanded us. Paul also warned us numerous times. And we have heard this from our pastor for the past few preachings. Paul warned us a lot of times. Peter warned us as well. 2 Peter 2:1-3. But there were false prophets also among the people. Even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privately shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that brought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. John warned us in 1 John 4:1-3. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Are they telling us to neglect all these verses for the sake of soul winning? Or should we win souls and obey these verses at the same time?
Right? Because marami pong binigay ang Panginoon na duty ng simbahan that we have to take para bang dapat natin pasinin. And our church is guilty, of course, of things that we take, that we neglect. You know, there are many ministries that God gave the church, and maybe not all of them are being done faithfully by this church. And it's time that we look at all of them and we do all of them. Christ gave also the one thing that we may be forgetting is Christ gave us the ministry to help the poor. And we may be doing that in one form by going to the villages and helping them with the things that they need, but we can do more about that. Right? That's why hindi lang po puro contending for the faith, of course, hindi lang puro soul winning, of course, marami po tayong dapat sundin sa Bible that Christ gave the church to do. And it's not just soul winning. Minsan isasampal nila sa inyo yan para lang tumahimik. Right? Yesterday, there was this post by Rufino Aramburo. He posted CBBC, anong lugar ni Pastor Ed? San Pedro, and their church-wide soul winning. Ang laki, isang buong street, soul winners. Kasi daw mas okay daw yun kaysa dun sa National Baptist Day. Yun yung po, kaya niya pinost yun. Pero nag-comment ako, pare-pares lang yan, sabi ko. Actually, mas okay pa ako sa National Baptist Day kaysa sa AC Believism. Kasi yung mga tao po na obsessed sa soul winning, and I say obsessed because it is an obsession of theirs, are obsessed with the numbers game. And this is where they fall into easy believism. Why? Because easy believism will give them the most results, will give them the most numbers to report, will give them the most people in their church. But what they don't realize, and they got mad at me, is easy believism is pushing people closer to hell. Yeah. They got mad at me. Basta't kahambugan na comment, mag-aasahan namin sa'yo. Anong kahambugan? Sinabi ko lang naman na yung easy believism is against the Bible. And it's really pushing people closer to hell. And for example, I'll give you an example. Kasi hindi ako nag-i-illustrate para magaya ko si Pastor. Come here. What's your name? Van. Money. Because I've been part of this easy believism scheme, right? I've been a part of a Bible Baptist Temple. And sa mga nag-aaral po doon, sa lahat inyong nag-aaral, o si Ate Blue lang, alam niyo po yung pamamaraan namin ng soul winning. So we go out, shortcut ko na lang, we meet someone, kung ano mang ginagawa niya, kumakain ng isaw or whatever, pwede ko makausap. And then after that, we introduce ourselves, and then Romans Road, blah, 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 blah. And then at the end of that, what do you call this? Presentation, you have to draw the net. You draw the net, sinner's prayer. So repeat after me. After that, amen. Ang utos sa amin, after that, dapat maging masaya kami. Sa pangalan ni Jesus, amen. Wow! Brad, congratulations! Alam mo, itong araw na ito, I'll just speak in Tagalog because it's hard to do it in English, you know. Itong araw na ito, ligtas ka na. Anak ka na ng Diyos. Alam mo, sabi ng Bible, 1 John 1:12, ganito, you're now, pagka ba nagkasala ang anak, hindi na anak. Ha? Pagka ba nagpumatay ang anak, hindi na anak. Siyempre, anak pa rin. Kaya sa araw na ito, tandaan mo, January 26, 2020, sarado na ang impyerno sa'yo. Kahit anong mayari, hindi ka napupunta sa impyerno. Kaya pag may dumating dito someday na sisharean ka, tatanungin ka kung pag namatay ka sa kapupunta, ano sabihin mo? Sa langit. Amen. Bakit? Kasi tinanggap ko na si Kristo. Yan, ligtas ka na. Kaya pag kami dumapit sa'yo, yan ang sasagot mo sa kanila. Now, iwanan mo na, hindi mo na ulit makita yan. But he will live his life believing that he's saved. And every time someone comes to him, oh, narinig ko na po yan, tinanggap ko na po si Kristo, hindi na siya wiwitnessan. Eh, paano kung hindi siya naligtas? He was already on his way to hell, but now you just push him to the edge. Why? Hindi na, lalo na siyang mahirapan witnessan. And he will continue to live his life the same way, thinking he's saved because he prayed the prayer, kasi sinabi mo, sarado na yung pintuan ng langit sa kanya, hindi na ulit bubuksan. Ng impyerno sa kanya, hindi. Pero sa katotohanan, langit eh. Impyerno sa kanya, hindi na ulit bubuksan, walang susi kahit sino man, hindi na siya pupunta sa impyerno. Hindi ba doktrina ng diablo yan? Is that not the device of the devil? And I don't know how they cannot understand that. Hambog daw ako kasi sinabi ko yun. O sige na, sabi ko sa kanila. So, thank you very much. I hope you understand me. So that is easy believism. That is what it does to people. That is what it does to lost people. It just pushes them closer to hell. Do some people get saved under that kind of scheme? Sure.
They get saved. Why? Because you give them the Bible. And if the Holy Spirit works in their life, then they will get saved. But mas marami po na hindi naliligtas sa ganung klaseng presentation. And kung pipresent mo naman na maayos ang gospel, maliligtas at maliligtas din naman sila. I don't know why they go around cities, they go around places, they go around towns giving assurance like it's candy. Save kayo lahat, save kayo lahat, save kayo lahat, langit na kayo lahat. Ganun po yung ginagawa nila. They're pushing these people closer to hell. Why? For the sake of numbers, for the sake of this soul winning. What they're doing is soul pushing, actually. What they're doing is not really presenting. You know, if you read, nabasa ko kaninang umaga, one of this testimony of Jack Hyles' disciple, they have this famous bus ministry, right? So they gather children, get them into the bus, and then they preach to these children. And the testimony goes like this. Children will not be listening. When they're preaching, they're noisy. Pero tuloy-tuloy lang. They just keep on preaching. And after the preaching, hey, everyone quiet. Repeat after me. We're going to pray. Who wants to go to heaven? Hey, want to go to heaven? Oh, repeat after me. After that, you pray. Okay, after mag-pray, oh, ligtas na kayo. Palit kayo ng damit. Ibabaptize namin kayo right there. Kasi nagdadala sila ng sarili nilang baptistry. Baptist na sila. Ligtas na silang lahat. Paglaki nila, maging terorista man yan, ligtas yan. Eh, binigyan mo ng assurance. You know, through these people, nawalan na po ng trabaho ang Holy Spirit. Kinuha na nila lahat. Sila na ang gumawa ng trabaho. Sila na ang nag-present, sila na ang nag-convict, sila na ang nagligtas, sila na ang nagbigay ng assurance. Kaya nga po, this atheism is the enemy of the gospel. And this springed out of the principle that let's just go soul winning. Why? Forgetting the Word of God. And later on, at the last part, we're going to look at how important the Word of God throughout all of these things. Another thing is, don't criticize until you have proven something. Ang dami ko na po napakinggan. Ano na ba napatunayan mo? Mapapakukumpara mo ba yung mga naligtas mo sa mga naligtas ni Pastor Ed? Sabi na sa akin gano'n, yun ang problema, siya nagliligtas. Eh di lalo na siya nagalit. But I don't see it anywhere in the Bible at all. Right? Saan nakalagay po sa Bible na hanggat wala ka pang gawain, huwag kang magkikriticize? There's no disclaimer whenever we are commanded to judge the teaching of people. There's no disclaimer whenever we are commanded to look at the Bible if what the preacher is saying is true or not. If you're saved, that command is for you, you have to obey it. It doesn't matter. Kaya nga, ang hirap, paano mo sila makikriticize? Ngayon, kung tagal na nila sa ministry, kailangan lagpasan mo, edi mag-isibilibisi muna ako, lagpasan ko yung number ng naligtas niya bago ko siya pwede i-criticize. That is wrong. Now, maybe it sounds good. Respetuhin nyo naman, senior pastor na yan. It sounds good, but then, we are not obligated to respect people who are baboyizing the Word of God, right? Who are not really obeying the Word of God. And yesterday, this is one of the ugliest statements that I heard. I told him that Christ, you know, does not expect numbers from us. All He requires of us is faithfulness. It's nasa Bible po yan, ha? So I expect him to maybe agree. Yes, true, but yun ang in-expect ko, that's the worst. But what he did was, ha ha ha, andaling sabihin yung faithfulness kasi hindi nakikita. Ano sabi mo? That is what is written in the Bible. Required to be faithful. And what we are to do is to be faithfully preaching the gospel, faithfully preaching the Word of God, and let God give the increase. Right? It is God who will give us the numbers. If God gives us a lot of numbers, then praise the Lord. If God doesn't give us, then praise the Lord. Ang kailangan lang po natin to be faithful in preaching the gospel. Kaya nga sabi niya, wag yung faithfulness, dapat yung naparami ng church. Ano? Wala nga yun sa Bible. Yung faithfulness nga yung nasa Bible, tatawanan mo. Sabi ko sa, ayun, hindi ko na siya kinausap ulit. Why? Because I believe he's a deacon of a huge church. But apparently, he's not reading his Bible. Kasi tinawanan niya yung faithfulness. I told him, ewan ko kung bakit mo tatawanan yung ganyang bagay. Kasi yun yung nakasulat sa Bible ko. Ewan ko, yung nakasulat sa Bible mo, sabi ko sa kanya. But then, he laughs. He said, ay, faithfulness, andali lang sabihin niya kasi hindi nakikita. But God sees that, if you're really faithful. And because they focus on this thinking that the ministry, success in the ministry can be measured by what you see. Right, success in the ministry can be measured by how beautiful your building is, by how many people, members you have, by all these things. But God looks at one thing alone, faithfulness. Are you faithfully doing what I'm telling you to do? If you are, don't worry about the result. It is God who will give. And minsan, hindi man malaki yung binibigay ng Panginoon na resulta. Look at those pioneer missionaries in places that are that have not been reached by the Word of God, right? These pioneer missionaries never really converted, a lot of people, but they opened the doors for other missionaries to come and then reap the fruit of what they have sown. Why? Because it is, what did Paul says, Apollos, basta, iba yung nagtanim, iba yung nagdilig, pero it's God who gives the increase. That's why we don't have to worry about the increase. Just faithfully do what we are called to do. Now, my last point, and then we'll dwell on this more. Doing more serving is more important than doing more study of God's Word. Now, you can never really read this word for word. But this is what they say. Ito yung kanilang punto. Mas maganda pa, focus na lang tayo sa paglilingkod. Tama na yung pag-uusap ng Word of God kasi nagtatalo-talo lang tayo. Mag-serve na lang tayo. Meron pa magko-condemn sa'yo sa pag-aaral mong salita ng Diyos kasi aral ka daw ng aral. Kaya yan ang nangyayari sa'yo. So their message is to do more serving instead of doing more study of the Word of God. What we don't realize is that the knowledge of the Word of God is prerequisite to service. Amen. Without the knowledge of the Word of God, you will never know how to serve God. Right? Let's go to our text. And please bear with me. I'll make this point at the end of the message. But I want to go through these verses. The Bible says, 2 Timothy 3, verse 13 muna. But evil men, and this is something that I learned through listening through the messages of the Sunday school of Pastor Jesse. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse. This is the time that we are in now. There are evil men and there are seducers. Now, we have to know these people. Yung evil men, madali pong malaman. It's easy to know them because they're evil. They're doing bad. They're doing things that are not really wrong. And even though you don't know the Bible, you can point them out, right? But there are also seducers. These people are people who are wearing righteousness. These people are people who are dressed to be good people. But then they are seducers. They're supposed to look good. They're supposed to sound good. They're supposed to be seducing. Because you will never be seduced by something that is bad. So these people are dangerous. And the Bible says that they will wax worse and worse. Now, how bad? Deceiving and being deceived. That they themselves will be deceived by their own deception. That's why you see these cult leaders who started out small, but then when they grew big, eventually they will start to believe their own deception. And they become worse and worse in their own deception. That's why nakakaroon po ng mga kulto na yung in America where they drank poison together. They were isolated in a place and then they drank poison all together. Why? Because the leader himself got deceived by his own deception that he started believing his own deception. Kaya nga po pagka nagsimula ka sa na magpaloko, at magpaloko at magpaloko, darating po yung panahon na talagang paniniwalaan mo na yung sariling pangluloko na yan. It become worse and worse. Pero ano po yung solution? But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned, has been assured of, knowing whom thou hast learned them. So first thing is you learn them. You know about them. You read the Bible. Someone taught it to you. But then you are to be assured of them. How do you do that? By studying the Bible for yourself. Now you hear the preaching, you learn. You go home, you look at the Bible, you confirm that it's true, you're being assured of that, right? And not only through the studying or personal study of the Word of God, but also through the Holy Spirit. Why? Because it's the Holy Spirit, His ministry is to lead us, to teach us truth, and to guide us into all truth. That's why whenever the preaching is going on, the Holy Spirit will confirm to you that is truth. And then you have been assured of that. So the Holy Spirit and through the Bible. But not only that we are to learn and be assured of, but we are also to be careful of whom we are learning from. Knowing of whom thou hast learned them. Now, Paul is referring to himself. Knowing that I'm the one who taught that to you. And I'm credible, Paul said. Why? Because I'm living what I'm preaching. I'm doing what I'm saying to you. And whatever I'm teaching you, it comes from God. It's credible. That's why we have to be careful who we're learning from. When we watch YouTube and we listen to preaching, ingatan po natin. Sino ba ito nagtuturo? Why? Because if we know that the person has a personal agenda, then it's better not to listen to them anymore. Right? But that's why the other day, when we were going to outreach, kasi our problem when we go to outreach is we get sleepy. And hindi po problema yan sa mga kasama ko, pero problema po sa akin yung nagda-drive. So ang ginagawa ko po, nagpikinig kami ng preaching. But sometimes, pag si Pastor Jesse, naantokin din minsan eh. Kasi baka pakinggan siya. Na, naantokin ka rin minsan. Kasi hindi siya sumisigaw at di nagpapatawa. So sabi ko, pakinggan namin si Joey Sauco. So nakinig kami sa kanya. Hindi naman po talaga kami inantok. Ako hindi ako inantok. Sila hindi rin sila inantok. Kasi kakaiba po yung preaching. Nakaka-entertain. Okay?
You know what I'm saying? Yung mga bagay niyang yun. But then, minsan, tinatawa na natin, pero if you keep on listening to that every day, maniniwala ka. Kasi nanggaling na po ako dun eh. Idol ko po yan. For a long time. You know, he will preach sa temple, every church we're giving, and hindi po namin siya malalapitan kasi dami nakapila, nagpapapirma, nagpapicture. So what we do, the Bible students, we go to the parking space, and we for sure he will go there kasi sakyan niya yun. Doon kami maghihintay. Kahit gaano katagal, doon kami maghihintay. Para pagdating niya, makapagpapicture man lang kami sa kanya. That's how we really look up to him. Why? Siya narinig namin, again and again, people raising him or whatever. But then, repetition, listening to these people will really make you believe them. Kaya po, ingat po tayo. Now, if you're really grounded, well-grounded in truth, then go ahead, listen to them so that you will know how to warn people of their message. But then, let's be careful of whom we are listening, of whom we are learning from. Kaya kung alam mo na yung nagpipreach is preaching truth, then go ahead and listen. The Bible says, and that from a child, thou hast known the Holy Scriptures. That is why we know that we can start teaching our kids the Bible. Not just Bible stories. Not just kids' stuff in the Sunday school. But we can teach our kids the truth from the Word of God. Why? Because this is which will able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. There will be no salvation apart from the Bible. There will be no salvation apart from the knowledge of the truth of the Bible. That's why when we preach the Bible so people can be wise unto salvation. And even kids can be saved if they have been given the Word of God and the Holy Spirit will convict them. What did the Bible say in Romans 10:14? How then shall they call on Him whom they have not believed? How shall they believe on Him whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Ano yung ipipreach ng preacher? It's not stories, not illustration, but the Word of God. And you will never be saved apart from that. So which will make you wise unto salvation. And then let's go into the next verse. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. Which is, which we preach this a lot, but the question is, are you treating the Bible as something that comes from God? Kasi, isipin mo lang yun. This book comes from God and He wants me to study it. All scripture comes from God. And it's profitable, the Bible says. Profitable meaning it will help you increase. It will help you be more, to be a better believer. It's profitable for us. For what? For doctrine, for teaching. We use the Bible to teach, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. All of these things, I will not go to every word here because it's a whole other preaching. But the point here is, the whole Bible is needed for us to grow. Okay? All scripture. Bakit daw? That the man of God may be perfect or complete or to be matured. And thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So the Bible, knowledge of the scripture, knowing the Bible is prerequisite even before applying it into good works. Even before service. That means, bago ka maglingkod, alamin mo muna kung paanong maglingkod. That's why the statement, doing more serving is more important than doing more study of the Word of God. It's the other way around. You study the Word of God, and as you know the Word of God, as you know Christ, it will urge you to serve more. Serve Him more and serve Him more. And that can only result from proper study of the Word of God. Why? Because if you preach without studying, what are you going to preach? Right? If we go soul winning without studying the Word of God, it will result into easy believism. If you give your money without studying the Word of God, mas pagsasamantalahan ka lang ng mga preacher na mapagsamantala. If you keep on singing in the church and you don't know the Word of God, kakanta ka ng mga kanta na hindi according to Word of God. If you teach Sunday school that you're not deep in the doctrine of salvation, then you might lead these kids into believing that they're saved when they're really not. And if you preach without studying the Word of God, then that's worse. Right? Because studying the Word of God is prerequisite to service. Kaya po hindi tunay na maglingkod ka na lang, hayaan mo na yung pastor sa pag-study. No, hindi ka makakapaglingkod hanggat di ka nag-aaral ng salita ng Panginoon. Because you will never know how to serve Him properly. You will never know how to glorify Him. Right? Even if you do good, if you don't read the Bible that you have to do this because of the love of God that is in your heart and because you love God, wala rin kwenta yung paggawa mo na mabuti. Why? Because you have not read the Bible na yun dapat pala ang attitude mo. Kaya po hindi yung lingkod lang ng lingkod. Totoo! Pero naglingkod tayo bakit? Dahil yun ang sabi ng Bible. Dahil yun ang nabasa ko sa Bible. Dahil yun ang sinabi ng Panginoon. Dahil sinusunod ko kung ano yung sinabi ng Panginoon. So doing more study of the Word of God, the correct statement is doing more study of the Word of God will urge you to do more service to the Lord.
Amen.
That is the truth. And that is the proper way po sa atin. Kaya nga po, don't neglect the study of the Word of God. Why? Because you will waste your time serving Him. Why? Kasi hindi mo alam kung paano mo siya properly to serve Him. Kaya nga po, kahit sa malilit na bagay, sa pagkanta, sa pagbigay, kailangan alam mo yung doktrina para sure ka na yun ang gusto ng Panginoon. Sayang man lang. Diba? Bigay ka ng bigay, hindi mo alam yung doctrine of giving and doctrine of being faithful stewards of the Lord. All that happened to you was you lost money. That's it. But you were not able to glorify the Lord. Let's not neglect that. And there are many more statements that I know I don't have time to go through. But then, if some of these statements you were living by sa buhay mo, then I believe that it's time to just dig deep into the Word of God and apply what you read in the Bible, not what the good things that you hear from other people. Because all of these things are good to hear. Let's just serve more. So what's important is we're serving God. Amen. Spiritual, biblical, okay? But then, we forget that we have to study the Word. It's prerequisite. Sabi niya, ano sabi ng Bible? Thoroughly furnish unto all good works. Eto muna, and then apply. Eto muna, and then do. Eto muna, and then serve. Eto muna. Alamin niyo muna. Know more about me. And then you will know how to please me and how to glorify me. That's why, let's not neglect that. Don't criticize until you have proven everything. That's proven something that is not found in the Word of God. Let's just go soul winning. We have to go soul winning. We're going to have our missions conference. That means we give importance in the Great Commission. But we also give importance in contending for the faith. But we also have to give importance in the things that we are neglecting as a church. And as members of this church, help us to see the things that we are neglecting. Para hindi po natin tayo maging guilty sa Panginoon na kinalimutan natin. If there are things that the Bible says that we're not able to give more attention to, bring it up. Tell us. And then we're going to do that and improve for the glory of the Lord. That's why, I don't know if any of you here, I think this message is more profitable for those who are engaged in social media answering these people. But then if you're not really that engaged and you don't really have that desire, that is another wrong principle. It's another wrong principle. Why? I don't know why you should be ashamed of the truth. Because, simply because it's the truth. That's it. It's the truth. And anyone who will terminate their relationship with you because of the truth is not worth your friendship. It's not worth your time. It's not worth your effort at all. Whoever that is. Right? If they think that your relationship is above truth, then they are not the people you should be with or you should be fellowshipping with. Anyway, the Lord will replace them. We have proved that. Yeah, marami po tayong nawalang kaibigan, but God placed the right people in fellowship with us, right? We have we met Pastor Angel, Pastor Jesse, and all of these people who are coming here who helped us to be deeper in the Word of God and to help us start on our way to question the things that we were doing in the light of the Word of God. And God only did that when we started to say that the truth is more important than friends. And when we decided, that's when the Lord started to move. Kung pinapansin nyo lang po ang timeline ng Panginoon sa ating simbahan, you can see that. But until and unless na na-realize po natin that the Word of God is above everything, that nothing ever happened po sa atin. But then, when we realize that by the grace of God, dun po tayo pinagpala ng Panginoon with friends, with people who are faithful to the Word of God, and who will only lead us closer to the truth of the Word of God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, that we have seen some of these things from the Word.